So I didn't really think about logic much, with one very, very big exception, and that is this. I liked number theory, and in high school, the first year of college, I read a book by Cohen and Wright, Theory of Numbers, a lovely book. And I particularly liked the part about partitions, decompositions into squares. And you get a feeling that Jacobi and those early people had developed almost the calculus of infinite power series expansions for which they deduced many of these wonderful results. So the thought began to occur to me, was there a calculus of power series which could reduce every question of this type in the same sense that there's a decision procedure for polynomials? And I had read almost no logic. So I thought about it, and I thought I was making progress. What I essentially was doing was rediscovering how to formalize number theory and elementary facts about recursive functions. And I was very happy with myself. And I came to the University of Chicago and told people this was my dream. Well, there weren't many students who were into logic then, and there was nobody in the faculty, with the exception perhaps of Saunders and McLean, who had written a thesis in logic, but essentially hadn't kept up with the subject in many, many years. And some of the students said, well, we think this violates Gödel's theorem. I said, what's Gödel? I said, well, Gödel's theorem is a theorem of philosophy. It has nothing to do with concrete problems in number theory. I just couldn't believe it. So they said, well, Cleaney is going to come and give a lecture to Chicago. Why don't you ask Cleaney? So Cleaney came, and there was a Cleaney, that was a very great professor. You only saw him at tea time. And so there was a tea, and I walked up to him. Question, he said, well, what is it you want to do? And I told him, and then in a very firm voice, he said, no, that's impossible. I've never thought about Gödel's theory. So I thought it was time to read Gödel's theorem. But I still was very dubious, so I got Cleaney's book, Introduction to Better Mathematics. I read it, and I started to read that section. And I still had the impression that nobody could prove something about number theory by reasoning about general things about what is true, what is a proof. And so I read it, sketched it, and for a few days, I was convinced it was wrong. And I went up to one of the older students and said, look, I found a mistake. And he was rather contemptuous. And after a few days, of course, I realized Gödel's proof was right. But it was almost, elating and at the same time, almost depressing to think that this man was so superior to me that by thinking in the most general terms, he could derive a result which had tremendous implications for number theory, at least the kind of things I wanted to do. So he was my master. I mean, the name of Gödel, I still wasn't too interested in logic. Cleaney's book, maybe somebody can correct me, had very little about set theory. And I couldn't even find a reference to his result on constructible sets, other than the Princeton monograph, which I was talking with Billy Putnam, is notoriously opaque. And one of the minor offshoots of my work is I felt that people lost their fear of that monograph. They saw, well, you can actually work with this stuff. But it was very difficult to read. Actually, Sullivan, in the collected works, discusses why he thinks Gödel wrote it in such an incomprehensible way. But so he was. He was a very meticulous person. So I was lying in bed, not being able to sleep, still suffering from jet lag. And I thought, well, I need some jokes. I need some literary references. And some thoughts came back to me in my bed, in my strange state. And I remembered I had an English teacher in New York City, Mr. Seligman, who was a great admirer of the essays of Francis Bacon. I think many of you are from Anglo-Saxon background, so you know, of course, the essays of Francis Bacon. And he wrote one of his essays called Of Truth. And what does he say? What is truth? Said Pontius Pilate, and would not stay for an answer. So that was the discussion of truth. But there's another concept of truth which occurred to me, and that is another one of my heroes in my late teenage years was the novelist Marcel Proust. He said, what is memory? The truth of memory, you know, something is gone, long gone, but is the memory the truth of what happened? And I feel that way of Gödel. When I heard that music, it actually made me feel quite emotional. And I thought, well, he heard this music, and he really liked it. And I never discussed music with him, but I think it was said it was his favorite piece. And so suddenly his image came back to me. The other weird feeling I must tell you, there's a lovely exhibit on Gödel. I will say something, perhaps I shouldn't. My wife is probably, she shaking your head right now. I think it's a lovely exhibit with one very bad exception. I don't think references to his wife were at all appropriate. And I think they should have been omitted completely. Anyhow, I was walking down the steps, and suddenly I saw this marker on the steps. It said in German, "On this spot was murdered Professor Schlick," I forget his name. And it sort of sent chills up my spine, partly because I'm Jewish and I thought, well, he was murdered by the Nazis. It wasn't quite correct. But there was also a weird similarity that I had a colleague who was murdered by a deranged student also, called Lou. And so that also gave me a very strange feeling. So the question is, what do you mean by truth? Well, one thing we discussed at the panel the other day was how many people were formalists, how many people were realists. Realists are those who believe that the abstract world of sets exists and every statement is either true or false. I want to propose something which I'm sure will be hotly poo-pooed by people like Hugh Wooden, but I think in my work we have an alternative thing. We have many universes and they're very rich and they involve mathematical complications. Cy Freeman refers to the fact that Gödel's work on set theory involved mathematical technique. Well, I'm teaching a course right now in set theory, and I found it hard to remember some of the details. So my work really did get into some tricky points. And so now we have to construct all these universes, and in some sense, I'm very happy with that. I don't claim that this in itself initiates the program of people who want to describe it. Well, so anyhow, I came to Chicago and I read Gödel's proof, and I felt a little bit depressed by it, but I said, I better stop thinking about decision procedure for diophantine equations, because this fellow seems to have definitely shown it's impossible. So I stopped thinking about that. And I did come back to set theory, or to logic really. I did look a little bit further in Cooney's book, and there was a group of people, not a very large group, including Raymond Smullyan, the author of a very funny paradox essay, which I've written down, I intend to tell it as soon as possible. So in analogy with my remark about, don't worry if the story is true, it's a good story, just tell it. I'm thinking of a wonderful remark of Oscar Wilde when at a dinner party a woman said to him, "Ah, Mr. Wilde, that was a wonderful bon mot you got off. I wish I had said it." And he said, "Don't worry, madam, you will." So anyhow, I love that paradox of Raymond. And at that time there was a great interest amongst Raymond and some other people about post-prop. And that's a problem which could have interested me. It had a mathematical flavor to it. But I never thought about it. And occasionally we have coffee and I hear these people talk about it. But one day someone came to my office and said, "This problem's been solved." And I said, "Really? Yes, here's the letter, but I can't believe it's true." And he gave it to me and I read it and I went to the blackboard, took some chalk. I said, "Well, it seems right, it seemed clever. This was the proof by Friedberg." And so that was my only contact with logic at that point. But I still never lost this idea of somehow thinking about the foundations of mathematics, trying to find some kind of inductive technique for simplifying propositions, perhaps leading to a decision tree, which is impossible. So if the story about Hartley Rogers is true, it probably corresponds to that period we were discussing logic. I do remember meeting Asriel Levy. He was visiting MIT. We had a brief discussion. Again, he rather poo-pooed what he thought was my naive ideas about how to think about mathematics. And so the matter stood until I came to Stanford. And by that time, I had actually left harmonic analysis. I was working in differential equations primarily. But somehow the bug had bitten me. I wasn't aware of when the bite happened, but something had happened. And I couldn't get the idea that I had a way of thinking about the foundations of mathematics. And so I gave some lectures about my ideas of how to build up a consistency proof. But again, I felt a deep sense of frustration. I remember one day shaving and looking myself in the mirror, and I said, "You poor fellow, you're driving yourself nuts. You'll never be able to do this. You think your ideas are correct, but you're just never going to get anywhere with it." So I felt rather depressed. But nevertheless, they stuck. And now some people ask me, I use the word intuition in mathematics, because I believe very strongly that great mathematics comes, is simple, and in some sense, comes as a flash